As I said, my name is Andrew Kuhn. I am honored and excited to have been appointed to serve as your pastor. And part of being a pastor and servant here is what I wear. In a minute, we're wondering what this funny looking thing you got on. Let me tell you. If you want to get an ox to pull, what do you got to do to it? Got to yoke it, right? This is the yoke of the church. It's called stole. He who wears it or she who wears it is marked as one who is in service, who's working. And then the cincture, this the rope, has a fancy word to it, called the cincture. It's a rope. But it's something, tie it and then in the shape of a cross, and it's a mark of vows of humility and service. So I don't wear this because I'm educated or I'm smart or anything else. I wear it every time I put it on. It is a reminder that I'm here to serve you. And I'm not just here to serve you. I'm appointed to Shelbina. Now, y'all are part of Shelbina, and there's some Shelby County folks. Shelbyville. Where are the Shelbyville folks? Y'all? Excellent. I'm a servant of Shelbina, Shelbyville, the Shelby County. I'm here to serve everyone. And y'all happen to be the chunk in front of me, for which I'm very, very thankful. I bring a set of experiences which you will hear about as we share many cups of coffee. You'll hear about, I'm a child of the suburbs. I grew up west of Joliet, and my graduating class is nigh on 400. They have a climbing wall in the school. They have metal detectors when you walk in to make sure you never bring handguns in. So I come from a different background, and then went off to get a degree in biology from Truman. And while I was at Truman, at the campus ministry there, Jesus got my attention. I was an atheist until I was about 20, and then Jesus hit me upside the back with the end of a 2x4, and now I'm a Christian. So it works out well. I then went off to Duke for a Master's of Divinity, and if you can find a more pompous title, I want to know. I am a Master of Divine. Yeah, seriously, if you can find a more pompous title. I'm an Eagle Scout with a fondness for knives and fire. I am a musician who wishes to get more time to pick up my trombone. It doesn't happen often. And I do play video games, so if you play or watch your children play Halo, I will gladly take them on. I have a particular fondness for the grenade launcher. things you never thought you'd hear from the pulpit. I run jazz festivals and conferences. I've been part of an urban ministry. I spent some time at an urban ministry that spent $600,000 a year in meal assistance, fed 350 people a day in lunch, had housing for 80, had sent out groceries, clothing for everyone who walked in the door. I've been a street pastor for 2 years in Durham. I've led worship by the side of the highway under a tent. It was wonderful. So they're going to have worship outside next week at Honeywell. I can't wait. I love you worship where the people are. I've now served after my adventures in North Carolina. I have now served in rural North Missouri for 11 years. I was 4 years over at Buckland and Mount Zion, which was wonderful, and then I spent 7 years at Milan in Green City. And I was adding up. I've been serving pork. To say Jesus loves you is great. To say Jesus loves you and hand someone a hot, piping, fresh, really tasty piece of pork, that's got some. That's grace, right? So I've had it up. I think I've served almost a ton of pork as a way to say Jesus loves you to my communities. So I look forward to figuring out how we're going to do that in this community. I do have a family. Many of you probably know my very talented wife, Olivia. Good wave. She is an amazing musician, a gifted teacher. She taught at South Shelby. She preceded and followed Tim Hercules and his little jaunt to get a master's. So if you've seen her before, that is probably how. She is the mother of Fletcher and Sophia. Fletcher is two. He is so very two. And he loves his Thomas. If you see little blue Thomas the Trains floating around the church, don't worry, he's not seven. We have redundancy of Thomas. But that's who they are. And Olivia, our daughter, Olivia and I's daughter, Sophia, loves pink and princesses, and she will not be anywhere near us forward to tell you about that. She'll be a bit shy. Now, there are stories that I could tell, many more. There are stories, more importantly, that I look forward to hearing. I look forward to hearing about this the families, this community. I know bits and pieces. I ran a camp up at Jehoda for multiple years, and so I know there are some berries over yonder. And does anyone know any Willowites?
Yes.
Steve Willowite and I, we chat at times. Really, Steve sings love songs to my wife. With my wife? At my wife? With, yeah. Tomorrow night, actually. So I know bits and pieces just enough to know that there's so much more to know. There are questions I don't know to ask yet, and I can't wait until you help me find them. I love a good story. I'm talking to Tim this week. He told me on the story of this book called Three Cups of Tea. You can't get anything done until you drink three cups of tea with folk, and I believe that. We have much tea, or we're Midwesterners, we'll drink coffee. We have much coffee to drink together, and I look forward to it. Now, I do believe that a question is a gift. It is by questioning that I came to my faith in Jesus Christ. It is by being with people who allowed me to question and to challenge and to push. And we read in the Proverbs that as iron sharpens iron, so does the mind of one sharpen the mind of another. And so if you have questions, I want to know. A question is a gift. It tells me that you care enough to get involved. And so in that spirit, y'all have any questions this morning? If you have a great question, I might have to tell you I'll answer it next week. But I love a good question. So if you have a question, just feel free to raise your hand, and I will take a swing at it. I've said a few things about myself. The most important thing I'll say today is not about me. The most important thing I'll say today is this. Jesus is Lord. The most important thing I'll say today, Jesus is Lord. When I say Jesus is Lord, those three words matter. Jesus was a first century Jew, fully human, fully God, whose birth, life, death and resurrection was so essential and central that we still mark time by it. What's the date today? What year? In the year of our Lord, 2017. Right? We are still marking time by the birth of Jesus Christ. Everything about our culture, everything about us is based upon marking time since the birth of Jesus. It is that essential to who we are. And if you want to know who God is, what do? You look at Jesus. He says he is the Son, so that tells us that there is a Father, and he says he's sending his Spirit. If you want to know about God, you've got to look at Jesus. That's the place to start. So Jesus is, not will be, not used to be, not will be in the future, right? Jesus is. Jesus is Lord today and tomorrow and every day that will follow, and Jesus is Lord. Lord is a powerful phrase. We have lost the power of that. When I say Jesus is Lord, well, that's an echo of in the first century Roman Empire. Well, second century BC through third century AD. But in that time period of the power of the Roman Empire, the way you committed yourself to Rome is you said, Caesar is Lord. And to say Caesar is Lord was to admit and confess that you were under the authority of the Roman legions. You were a part of the Roman economy. Like, the Romans built the roads. Why are railroad tracks that far apart now? Because that's how the Romans built their roads. So to place yourself under the power of the Roman Empire, you said Caesar is Lord. And so for us to say Jesus is Lord, there's a power to that that is far beyond something like saying Jesus is president. See the bumper sticker, Jesus for president? Right? The thing about president is you get to vote on who's president. You have a say in who's president. Do you have a say in whether Jesus is Lord? Nope. Right? Jesus is Lord whether you admit it or not. It's kind of like saying, that's the reason we don't say Jesus is my Lord. If I say Jesus is my Lord, what does that open up the space to respond? Right? Jesus is your Lord, but it's not my Lord. Right? You can say that if we start talking about Jesus is my Lord. But the lordship of Jesus does not depend upon whether we agree upon it in the same way that our agreement about what side of the road you drive on doesn't matter. Right? If you go out on the highway and you say, you might drive on the right side of the road, but I'm going to drive on the left side of the road, how far are you going to get? It doesn't matter what you believe. The facts are you drive on the right side of the road. Right? Whether you say Jesus is my Lord or not doesn't matter. Doesn't change the fact that Jesus is Lord. Whether you acknowledge it or not, that's the facts. That's what it is. To say Jesus is Lord changes everything about who we are. Jesus did not come so that we might think a few good thoughts and then go on with our lives. To say Jesus is Lord, Jesus came so that we might be transformed in our politics, in our economics, in our jobs, in our families, and everything about how we live is transformed by saying Jesus is Lord. When Jesus preaches his first sermon, which was admittedly far shorter than this, it's in Luke 4. He says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captive and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And he rolled up the scroll and gave it back to the attendant and sat down. And he said to them, today the scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing. Right, this is the moment which Jesus begins. And what does Jesus say from here and out again and again and again? The kingdom of God has come near. I am the Lord of this kingdom, and the kingdom of God has come near. That is the beginning of everything Jesus teaches and preaches and begins. It all is rooted in that moment when the kingdom of God has come near, and we are invited to be part of that kingdom to say Jesus is Lord. And so that's how I begin. I will spend as many years as the bishop blesses me with unpacking and explaining that phrase, Jesus is Lord. We're going to be chewing on that for Sunday after Sunday from here on out, because it's going to change us, it's going to guide us, and it's going to empower us to live lives that are like Jesus. And it's my invitation to you to join with me in that confession, to say Jesus is Lord, and to take it with a seriousness and an intentionality such that it shapes us and forms us, such that we take on its commitments and burdens, but also embrace the joy and peace that comes from saying Jesus is our Lord. We walk together in the footsteps of Jesus, who not only conquered death and desires us to follow it through death into the kingdom of come, but calls us to be transformed today. Following Jesus is not fire insurance for down the road, it is being part of the kingdom of God today, being part of a new way of living. It shapes how we live now. My friends, Jesus is Lord. Thanks be to God.